hope everybody enjoyed lunch. At this time, I'd also like to extend a special thank you to our Virginia Country Club staff for all the planning and attention to detail that went into this day, as well as the team over at the Southern California PGA for their assistance, as well as everything that they do for golf in Southern California. So let's give them a round of applause. At this time, I'd like to introduce Derek Uetta. He's the lead golf instructor at the Fairmont Grand Del Mar. He's the recipient of the Teacher of the Year Award from the Southern California section of the PGA, and he's been identified as one of the top golf instructors in the state of California by Golf Digest. He's a respected authority in the field of video swing analysis and is also regarded as one of the top short game and putting experts in the world. Derek also developed the putting plates, which are designed to assist golfers of all abilities to perfect aim, ball starting line, and green reading. The putting plates are trusted and utilized by many touring professionals as well as high-level amateurs, and are regarded as possibly one of the best tools in the game for putting. His current and former students include Xander Schauffele, Phil Mickelson, Charlie Hoffman, and Max Homa. Today, Derek will be discussing the legendary video collection of the late Carl Welty, along with some special guests. Please join me in welcoming Derek up to the stage.
Jamie, where's Jamie? Thank you very much for allowing us to do this. This is going to be a little bit more kind of a almost history lesson. Doug Timmons, John McLean, and Craig Welty, Carl's son. I think some of the most important stuff that I want to talk about isn't necessarily as much as the video. Craig actually put together a really cool video and that I'm going to try not to cry through. That's, I don't know, how long is it, Craig? 26 minutes. Were you going to be able to take a couple breaks in between? But everybody's going to be able to see some really cool stuff that probably nobody's ever seen before because Carl never showed it to anybody. But I kind of wanted to start with a quote from a player, and it says, "If it weren't for Carl Welty and his relationship with Derek, I would not be where I am today," and that was from Xander. I saw Xander last week in Las Vegas. He obviously didn't play, but I told him I was going to do this, and he knows how important Carl was to his development because he was not a very good putter. Emiliano Grillo's in that same boat. Emmy was 194th in putting when I got him, and now he's 73rd, and he's 35th in the world. You know, Phil helped Phil win a major championship at 50, and we talked about ball roll and some of the stuff that Carl talked about before Quintic ever came out. So I think it's important that everybody understands that I am just a small piece of what kind of Carl kind of started. I can't even tell you how long ago it was. But Carl died in February of 2018. And his instruction and the knowledge that he gave goes way deeper than the video. And Jamie titled it the Godfather of Video. And I'm not going to get into as much of what he did for golf instruction besides video. But I'm going to leave that to John and Doug and Craig. But just a little bit about myself and Carl. I met Carl through Doug, and immediately I kind of knew he was different than everybody else. The video, yes, that was a big part of it, and I think that's where everybody needs a mentor, right? Everybody in this room has probably had a mentor that has helped them along the way and helped them develop as a pro. But I busted my ass for him. I mean, I went and took days off of my weeks to go film, not get paid, go film. And for the first probably year and a half, my film was just shit. Like, it was horrible film. And he let me know it. Like, he was like, this is useless. What are you doing out there, Ueda? But then after a while, the way he taught me how to film was, he would look at my video, we'd sit down and we'd break it down in his living room, and And then he would tell me how bad it was. And then he'd show me a clip that he did. And he wouldn't say anything. He'd just show me a clip. And then gradually over time, I started figuring out, like, oh, I got to have the camera here. I got to have the target there. I got to frame the player in the screen like this. And so I think one of the things, you know, from and I mean, bad lighting, bad players. And I say bad players, I mean, he just wanted, like, the top 50 players in the world. He wanted the guys that were cleaning everybody else's clock every week. And so I'd film a guy that nobody ever knew of and would probably never see him again. And he's like, why are you wasting your time filming these freaking guys, right? And so, you know, in learning all this, he made a comment to me that is still a pretty big one. He said, you know, you film better than I ever did. But I did it. I mean, I did it a lot. So anyway, I take the saying of, you know, you give a man a fish and you can feed him for a day, but if you teach him how to fish, you give him food for a lifetime. And that's what he did for me. And I can't thank him enough. But Carl, when he first started filming, he used reel-to-reel movie film. Like, this was... I mean, I was born back then, but most of you guys are super. Carl had to been, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, not the first guy to start filming people teaching. I mean, he had to been, if he wasn't the first one, he had to been one of them, right? And so why did he start filming? So he told me this story about Paul Runyon. And Sean knows a bit about Paul a bit from being a pro at La Jolla and all that, but Runyon was giving Carl a chipping lesson, and I want to say he was in his teens, but I was talking with Craig, it could have been his early years as a pro working for him at La Jolla, but Runyon's giving him a chipping lesson. And if you guys know Runyon, I'm going to get up for this. So Runyon had in the videos that I've seen, he had a weak left, strong right, and it was his putting grip, and he would tell him, Carl, in this lesson, you know, you're kind of using your wrists. And Carl's telling him, well, I'm just copying you. And Runyon's, well, I don't use my wrists. And it was, yes, you do. No, I don't. Yes, you do. No, I don't. So they got one of the members from La Jolla to bring out this reel-to-reel movie film. This is a long time ago. And so they had to wait a couple weeks for it to get developed. So when they get it developed, they play it at La Jolla on a wall. And so here's Runyon chipping, and he's kind of giving it a little bit of the wrists. And so Carl goes, well, what do you have to say about that? And Runyon goes, well, I guess I do use my wrists. So Carl immediately kind of figured out, like, very quickly, the best players in the world, not just the best players in the world, but people think they're doing something, but they don't truly know. And so he said, well, if this is the case with one of the greatest that's ever played, I gotta try and figure this out. Like, I gotta figure it out. So he just started filming guys. And nowadays, these cameras on your phone, if you put it on slow motion, the shutter speed is set. Does anybody understand, like, shutter speed and how the shutter speed works on a camera? For the light to get through the lens, not just aperture or frame rate, but shutter speed. So these reel-to-reel movie cameras, he figured out that if he put his hand behind a fan and went like that, like, my hand's blurry right now, but if you did this behind a fan, it would look choppy and clean. So he put a fan in front of the lens of a reel-to-reel movie camera and was able to see club face. Like, this is so far beyond. And wait till you see some of the stuff that he filmed. I mean, that's what Carl filmed with. This is so, like it. So, and you can, I mean, you can come and take a look at it, but this is the impact that Carl Welty had on our profession. Because you can use force plates, and you can use 3D. And you can use TrackMan or Foresight or Full Swing. But video, I mean, how many of us teach lessons and don't use video. Occasionally, just pull your phone out and go, oh, this looks like you're doing this. And that's what Carl, like, basically started. And a couple just kind of quick fun stories. Carl and I had this conversation about great players and why there aren't any great offspring from great players in golf, but there are in football and basketball and baseball. And Carl is just, it was basically the same thing. The greatest players in the world or that ever walked the planet didn't necessarily know what they did, and they didn't necessarily know how to teach it. And my thing is, well, maybe they're just like my kids and they just don't freaking listen. And then the last thing I have to say is about Carl, which made me love him even more, is he just didn't have a lot of patience for stupidity. And, you know, as much success as I've had, you know, thankful to my pro here, Sean Cox, and allowing Carl towards the end of his time to come and teach at the Grand, I start crying. It was that where, you know, he wanted perfection and he wanted it all the time, and he wasn't really patient for guys that didn't really do it. So, that was something that was pretty funny to me. He would give it to people and you just had to take it on the chin. I know Doug got a lot of it because I'm smarter than he is, but we're gonna go John next. Jim McLean's son, John McLean.
Yeah, my relationship with Carl spanned a large part of my life. I'm sure I met Carl when I was a baby, but I really started to work on my golf game with him when I was 11 years old. My dad would take us out to PGA West, where Carl was, and we'd do that for every winter and spring break all through high school, and we worked with Carl every day. After high school, I took a year off in between high school and playing in college, and I lived with Carl for 4 months, again, working with him pretty much every day. So I was very fortunate to get to spend a lot of time working with Carl on my own game. And as a developing junior golfer, which Carl was phenomenal at developing kids, we heard a lot about that with Boyd this morning, and Carl would have liked Boyd, because he always thought being able to develop a kid from being a young kid to Division I college golf to even the PGA Tour was kind of like the highest benchmark for a teacher. That was something that was, I was very fortunate to get to do that with Carl. I think Carl was so successful for teaching kids and developing these young kids because the way he taught. He was not the type of teacher to tell you what to do. He wasn't going to say, you're doing this wrong, you need to do this, this, and this. A lesson with Carl was very collaborative, where you had to work together. He would guide you along the way, but he was really just leading you kind of through self-discovery, watching pro swings, talking over feels, going back and forth on video. And I think through that process, you really felt like you had ownership. So every time I left Carl, I felt so good about my game. Carl's enthusiasm about golf and watching golf swings it's hard to really describe if you didn't really be around him, but he was so into golf and golf swings, and he'd, you know, watch swings with you all day and night. So it was pretty special. And now as I've continued to transition into teaching, I mean, Carl is such an important part of how I teach. Every lesson I give goes back to the principles that I learned with Carl. And at the golf school in Miami, every assistant that has ever come through the school and is currently going through our, you know, certification and training process, they absolutely have a huge knowledge about Carl. It's kind of mandatory. We talk about Carl in pretty much every meeting. His influence on my dad and how we teach, how we film, how we research swings with our swing studies. It's kind of immeasurable how important he was to my dad and the golf school. So I think Carl's really grossly underappreciated in his impact on golf and golf instruction. So I think Craig put together an amazing video, and really fortunate that you guys are going to get to learn a little bit more about Carl and kind of his genius. So it's going to be fun.
And just real quick, if anybody has any questions at any time, feel free to ask, because we don't want you guys to miss an opportunity because we didn't allow it. So if anybody, just raise your hand. If you have a question, go ahead.
There you go. All right, I'm Doug Timmons, and I met Carl in 1991. I was coming down to Southern California from Chico, Northern California, to go to the Golf Academy. And before I left, my dad said, "Hey, what do you want to do when you get down there?" I said, "I want to coach. I just loved my coaches growing up, from football to baseball to golf, and I want to coach. I'd love to try it." He goes, "Well, go find the best coach down there and see if you can get a job." So I was caddying at Fairbanks, and I went over to the director of golf there, Tag Merritt, and I said, "Hey, Tag, who's the best coach in San Diego?" And he goes, "Well, not only is he the best coach in San Diego, but he might be the best coach in golf, and it's Carl Welty at the La Costa Golf School." So through, I won't go into the story too much, but let's just say it was a year of relentless pursuit of trying to work for him, getting yelled at multiple times, getting told to get the out of there, and finally I got a job working in the bag room, and I just happened to see him walk up to the golf shop every single morning, and I decided I was going to park a cart down there and tell him that the cart was for him. And he appreciated it. And after I'd already introduced myself to him probably 24 times prior to that, he took his hat off. He goes, "Carl Welty." And I said, "Doug Timmons, nice to meet you, I guess, all right?" And then it started from there. And I started out being kind of a spotter for him during lessons. And when he was filming during the Tournament of Champions at La Costa, he felt that one of his key things, if you didn't know where the ball was going when you were videoing, the video was fairly junk, and he wanted someone to always spot. So I started out as a spotter, gradually moved up to being able to hold the camera, and then turned into kind of a utility guy for him throughout the years. And some of my fondest memories are going to the golf school, and then after hours, you know, I'd go to his house, and it would be like, I said, "Oh, let's look at the change of directions, Crossroads number 2. And he goes, "What year? Who do you want to look at?" And if you couldn't even imagine, if you could imagine from wall to wall, this whole thing full of VHS tapes, about 9 feet high, wall to wall. And he would just go and look. And the best thing about it was he'd pull out the VHS tape, and there'd be a little piece of paper in it with every single swing completely numerized by sequencing of time. So if you wanted to go to Nicholas down the line hitting an 8-iron, you'd go, "Oh, that's a minute and 36 seconds. And then sure, here comes the remote. And, you know, it's just stuff like that over and over and over again until, you know, until his time was over. And it was quite a lot of fun, and inspired me to, during coaching, started a junior program. We did study sessions where I'd run films in the trailer up at Encinitas Ranch, and you know, trying to pass the torch on to all the kids, teaching them how to look at video and how to film and proper camera angles, and it's been quite an amazing experience. And that's what kind of I feel like we're here to do, is carry on the legacy and, you know, let people know who Carl was and what he did for our profession.
Okay, I'm Craig Welty. I'm Carl's youngest son of two. Obviously, being in the golf business as I am, my dad was my mentor, my hero, on multiple levels. But when it came to golf, anything he said was the gospel, and he didn't say a lot. But if he said it, people would stop and they would listen, because he wasn't full of any BS. It was straight to the point, and if it was an idea he had, it was an idea for a reason. So I'm going to give you just a brief history on my dad. I know we've talked about his legacy and how many people he touched over the years in such a good way, helped them with golf, helped them with career. He's been such a mentor to so many, and I think deep down he was never even trying to be a mentor, but he loved people with energy. He loved people that wanted to work hard, and those were the people he just wanted to be around. Because he wasn't going to give you the time of day. So my dad was born in San Diego in 1941. His dad, my grandpa, was a barber at the time, but wanted to be a dentist. And you'll see in the video today that my grandpa filmed his own swing. He filmed his swing, and he filmed my dad with a golf club as a kid. So that had to be the start of the filming golf to try to improve. And when my dad was 6 years old, they moved to Bell Gardens, which close to us here, while my grandpa attended dental school at USC. After that, they moved back to San Diego, and my dad started caddying for my grandpa when he was 11. He'd drive up from San Diego to Rancho Santa Fe, and that's where my dad's love of the game developed. So wherever you are in your stage of life, you know, to do what he did over his lifetime was pretty incredible looking back, but he just did it one little piece at a time. So he was went to Hoover High School, captain of the golf team, but he was also a lifeguard at the municipal pool, loved to surf and dive for abalone and things you could do back then in San Diego. He ended up playing golf at San Diego State, number two man behind Chuck Courtney. Many of you might know Chuck. And then he went into the Army. He was stationed at Fort Ord, and he really didn't like the Army too much, but he realized his calling was golf when all the people above him in the Army needed help with either their golf game, they needed a club fixed. He figured out an easy way to get liked and be able to get what he wanted. So he'd fix clubs, he would build clubs, he would help people with their games. And then in 1966, when he got out of the Army, he said his biggest break in golf was getting a job working at La Jolla for Paul Runyon. Now at this time, junior golfers in San Diego there were quite a few greats, but at this time at La Jolla, there was Runyon, there was Gene Littler, Chuck Courtney, Casper, Tag Merritt, Mike Riley, Phil Rogers. Quite a few greats just clumped right there at La Jolla. So my dad was able to be around greatness. And this is the time he really started studying golf swings and started studying the great players. And he got these reel-to-reel movies. He was dedicated to using those. And I have a note here that shows, like, Derek talked about his specifics on where to hold the camera and how to film. And this is, he must have sent somebody on a trip to Tucson and Phoenix, but this is using a 64 frame per second camera. He had the light setting. He's getting far enough away is one of the things that I see many people that film, they don't do, and that's down the line. So when you're filming someone down the line, if you don't get far enough away, that tends to skew the path. It makes it look inside out because of the depth of the field that we're dealing with on the camera. So it's the club head from one side to the other. Such a great depth of field that if you're too close with your camera, the swing usually looks a little more inside out than it is, and it's tough to tell. But if you're meticulous about the way you set up your camera every time, you're going to film and you're going to see the same thing over and over, and you're going to see exactly what you need to change if you're just comparing one swing to the other. If any of you are familiar with Sacred Links on Instagram, does anyone know that one? Colin is a wealthy disciple who puts up that page. We'll talk a little more later about Colin. But those are some tremendous examples. If any of you want to use those to help your students, it's a great Instagram page. Yeah, there's some other things, but so these are notes for the 1960s and 70s on filming, which no one was doing, so no one knew how to do it. But in 1969, Paul Runyon took the head pro job at Sahali. And the story my dad tells me is Tag applied for the job and then asked Mr. Runyon to write him a letter of recommendation to move to Seattle, cold, dark climate, huge trees. And so Tag has Runyon write this letter, and at the end of the letter, saying all these nice things about Tag, he said, P.S., what about me?
Did you know that one?
So, of course, they're going to have Paul Runyon. So Paul is the first head pro at Sahali. He said, Carl, come on, come with me. So he drove up to Seattle in his Rambler with cruise control. It was a 5-iron shaft that he put on the base of the seat, held down the gas pedal, and he ended up spending, 15 years in Washington State, 12 years at the club that I'm the current director of golf at. He really developed a lot of great juniors. Everyone from Western Washington would flock to Skagit, this tiny little club in the middle of farm country, to see Carl, and he left a big impact that still carries on today, generations later. So in 1984, he moved back to San Diego. We all did, the whole family, my brother, mom, and I. And he started the golf school at La Costa, and this was one of the first golf schools west of the Mississippi. This is where he met Doug and numerous other great juniors that ended up becoming All-Americans and golf pros, such as Todd Dempsey, who's featured in the video today, Pat Perez, other All-Americans. And then the Tournament of Champions would come through every year, so he got to know a lot of the best pros at La Costa, and then working with many of them. He had technology that no one else had at the time, and so everyone loved swinging on his swing analyzer that would register speed and path and yards carry, really developed his skill for teaching putting. Helped quite a few players doing that. And then his next stop, so he was at La Costa for 15 years, and his next stop was PGA West, where he got to work more in these years with Jim McLean, who Jim grew up in Seattle, for those of you who didn't know, and that's where my dad initially met Jim, and they'd been, started in the early 70s, they were very close, good friends ever since. But my dad spent 12 years there at PGA West, and then the last 7 or so years of his life at the Grand, and just helped so many people. And he had so many great characteristics, but so many difficult ones. He wasn't the most social person ever, and especially at the end of his life. He was brutally honest with people, which really helped him with working with good players. But it did put off some people, and it offended some people. And, you know, those people might have thought he was an asshole for a little while, and then later probably thought about it and said, oh, well, he was right. because rarely was he wrong. He never wanted to be the smartest guy in the room. He didn't act like he knew more than most. He just knew better than most. So yeah, there's maybe a couple other stories we might have, but I had a great childhood, great dad who loved filming me in sports, not just golf, but he filmed my soccer, baseball, birthday parties. I have videos of me as a little kid when, you know, no one else had a video camera because they looked like this. So, yeah, I guess he had so much patience, so much more patience than anyone here in this room, because in his generation they didn't have the need for the instant gratification. He would ask a trivia question pre-Google to me or my brother or one of his students or any of us, and he literally would not give you the answer for a month. And you'd look it up, and you'd try, and you'd guess wrong, and you'd guess wrong again. But he had so much patience and an ability to just withhold information and make you discover it. So I think you'll see that's the theme of the video, also the theme of what we knew of my dad. But he was so good at that, so good at withholding the answer and making you discover it yourself, because at that point, if you discovered it yourself, you will learn. Yeah.
100%. Does anybody have any questions about Carl or anything else?
I just think you'll think this is kind of cool. I knew about your dad, and because I'm really into, you know, golf, of course, and I actually have I call it the modern wealthy wall in my studio.
Oh, nice.
I put a white wall. Yeah. I know my students, and it's because all the years that the wall was black, I could never see if their elbow's in or anything.
Yeah.
And so I actually, I have a white wall behind every student.
Nice.
Because of your dad.
That's cool.
That's cool.
Yeah, he used masking tape usually on the wall. He'd paint it blue and then line it with masking tape just to see the movement.
Yeah. Do you want to run the video now, or do you want to talk about some of the stuff that he did? You want to run the video?
Yeah, because we have two pauses to talk.
Yeah. You guys ready to see some swings?
How many of you knew my dad? Sure. Cool. So living in Seattle, he hadn't been there for so long. It's rare that I even run across someone that knows my dad or knew my dad. But the story is the same whenever someone comes up to me and says, I knew your dad and this is what he did for me. And so all of you who teach know that, you know, it might be a grind. You might work with some difficult parents or people, but you are impacting lives in a very positive way. And that's the real rewarding thing for what we're doing.
Thank you. This is Friday, August 26th. I'm setting up so the shaft in my left arm is an extension. The shaft is the extension of my left arm, and the face is dead square to the target.
Lee Trevino's golf tip.
With the thousands of youngsters getting involved, the future of this great game lies in our junior golf programs. I try to get involved as much as possible. Watch. Oh, Craig, that was a beauty there. But you know, I did notice a little something, and I'm going to see if I can help you out with it a little bit. You know, I noticed that you've got a cross-handed grip. You think you could put that hand below the left one there?
Uh-uh.
You don't think so?
Uh-uh.
You don't think you can? Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you try one and see?
I knew he'd change right back. Go ahead.
Well, you can lead them to water, but you can't make them drink.
Swings were, you know, some of the greatest players that have ever played the game. And he got to film all of them. And that's, so he always wanted to know what the best of all time were doing. And the best way to figure that out, the only way he thought to figure that out would be to go watch him. Not only go watch him, but go watch him and film him. So if you ever find yourself with a chance to go film a tour event and actually capture some footage yourself for your own library, it's just so valuable.
Didn't he have like 9 or 11 fundamentals that all the greats did the same, and he never would share it with me? Will you possibly share it, or will you share it someday?
I'll share number one. The number one fundamental he discovered after, I guess we can call it 60 years of studying golf, more than anyone else I know that has studied golf, the number one fundamental that all the best players do, no matter what tour they're on, no matter what era they were in, is hit the center of the club face. And it, some of you might laugh, and it sounds really simple, but he would send a tour player home with only that to work on. And it was effective. His teaching was as simple as it gets, and it's kind of like when you go to the doctor and you know what the doctor's going to say, and you have to have the doctor tell you to say, okay, I will whatever, or the dentist, I will brush my teeth. He was like that. It was always a very simple idea from years of studying, and he had a set of fundamentals that if you could do all these things correctly, you were probably going to have success at the game. There's still other things involved. You had to have talent.
So getting back to some of the other things besides the video, I'm going to give another one away. I'll give number two. He felt that green reading was super, super important. If you couldn't read, putting was luck. And so I don't know how many years ago we started using. So I'm on tour. Well, I'm actually not on tour that much because I don't like to travel and I've got kids. But all my guys use a digital level. And Carl was the one that said, you need to get a level to figure out how much tilt is on the greens. And now every single play, I mean, John, how old is your level?
I've had the same level for 24 years.
Okay. So Carl had a level, you can imagine he used, well, what kind of levels did he use?
The first time I remember a level would have been the early 80s when he'd just set the bubble on the green. He didn't have a digital readout of how much break, but you could tell the break. And then next thing, he came up with a deal with two wheels on it that had the level with percent of slope that would go with the slope, and you'd roll it down your line. Then later on, when the digital level came out, that was a no-brainer. You could just set it down in three spots and check. But if you can't read greens, there's one other way you can still putt well, and it's if you can hire a caddy. They can read greens.
This was actually done. I think it was Hank Keeney. Hank Keeney had a caddy that could read. But so if you go out to a tour event now, every single player has a digital level in their bag. And whether they're using it for aimpoint or vector or whatever style you want to use, when I say every player on the tour has a level, every player on the tour has a level. Well, maybe Patrick Cantlay doesn't because he's different. Yeah. So I'll let Craig do it.
Great question. So my dad was meticulous on that. With most swings, it's target. You have to know the player's target. And not the start line target, the end target. Target, ball, camera, in line, and 10 yards behind the ball, unless it's a driver, and then 11 yards. Well, so much footage was from the shoulder held camera. Anywhere about this height's fine.
And then the way you frame the player would be the same distance from the ball to the bottom right edge of the screen would be the same distance from the heels to the bottom left edge of the screen.
Yeah. So, I remember getting the coals raked over me the first few times I filmed too.
Oh man, you waited. This is useless. So that way the player looks centered in the screen, and it's 2D video, so it doesn't distort it at all. Yeah.
Camera ball target line, final target.
Because that way, if you know where they're trying to hit the ball and they're set up like this, and next thing you know, they make a big end to out swing, and Xander calls it a lead out draw where the ball starts way right and comes back to the target, you can say, oh, well, the ball finished on the target line, so yeah, this is what he did. I mean, he doesn't need to set up to the right to do it. I mean, Trevino didn't do that. He set up way to the left. I mean, look at Bubba Watson. Like, it was really hard filming Bubba Watson when he first came out. And I won't say the F word, but it was really hard to tell where the hell the guy was trying to hit it because he was just aimed all over the place. But what he did with the club to get the ball to the target he's an outlier. He's 1-on-1, right?
Craig, I'm just trying to paint this picture, right? Especially with the footage of Steve and Hogan with Nelson. He had a fan out there while he's filming them?
No, that was after.
Oh, that was after.
Yeah.
Okay, because I'm just.
But
that would have been like the greatest picture in the world to have. Oh,
yeah.
And the quality on that old reel-to-reel is kind of grainy when it's blown up this big, but he was used to, you would view it in a viewfinder this big. You'd make a room dark, you'd turn it on and have a light in the back, and you'd reel it back and forth. So my dad always said, Ben Hogan's swing looked the best in pictures. But when it's actual real time, Snead's swing looked the best because of the rhythm and the tempo, like an Ernie Els or like a Fred Couples. I mean, they both look beautiful, but. Does anyone know how old Byron Nelson was when he retired? Isn't it amazing what he could do in that time? Derek already bought his ranch.
It is a ranch with snakes and coyotes.
I think one thing that I really hold dear to my heart about Carl was the way that when you were videoing that he always would ask you, why wouldn't you have a camera on that? So us as instructors were always trying to pick out that little feel that was different or a position that was different that a student could learn from. And if you didn't have the camera on it, how could you really have the student really grasp it themselves without standing there putting them in positions and stuff, making them actually learn and come up with the answer themselves? And he felt that, like, if you didn't have the camera on it, that you're wasting your time. And And as you get better and better and you start reaching, you know, if you're on a tour level, that you want, through the course of your progression, it's constant minor adjustments that, that you're always working on to stay at that certain level. And he felt that using a camera and having, especially at the highest learning level, those guys making their own decisions on what it was, as he kind of gracefully kind of led you into what the area was that was kind of breaking down.
I could tell one quick center contact story with Carl. When Carl was the head pro at Skagit, where Craig is now, there were two young boys that had never played golf before, and they came in wanting to learn how to play in the winter. And Carl gave them clubs, brought them down in the basement there to hit into the net, and he gave them zero instruction other than made them put face tape on every single shot and had them just hit balls for the winter down there with the face tape, working on just kind of seeing where they hit it on the face. And when the spring rolled around and the weather got better, they went out and played their first ever nine. They'd never even swung a club before. And one boy shot 42 and the other one shot 45, which is pretty cool.
Just one fundamental.
Yeah, center contact. No instruction.
One of his trivia questions, if everybody wants to think about it, is okay. Not counting like mini tours, senior tour doesn't count either. Club pro events doesn't count either. Everyone knows it would be Michael Block. Who has the most wins of all time? Heard some right answers. Kathy. He loves stumping young men with that one. Yeah. Okay, I think we can start the second part of the video.
Joining us, Carl Welty. He is the director of the Tommy Jacobs Golf School at La Costa. What does this computer do that a golf pro cannot do?
I can't see what's going on in that area. It goes so quickly. Somebody like Bob will probably swing over 110 miles an hour, and it's just impossible to see what's taking place.
Put his left hand thumb right on the top.
The swing went from here to right there to shorter.
That's kind of as he got older.
Okay.
Oh my gosh, Craig, I could go on and on about your dad, but I thought maybe I'd share a quick story on how I met Carl Welty. I was on the tour. I had a childhood friend, John Ashworth, caddying for me that had met Carl and was so impressed that John begged me to go see this guy, Carl Welty, who I had no idea who he was. And I had just shot 74 in the first round of the Andy Williams golf tournament there in San Diego, and said, okay, fine, I'll go in to meet Carl. And spent 3 hours with Carl the first time I met him, and at the end of that 3 hours, I felt like I was such a smarter golfer and a smarter putter. And it was priceless. I had no idea that Carl had all these tapes of great players over the years, and I went on to learn so much, I can't even tell you. I thought I was a really good putter. Well, I became a great putter. I became a great golfer after seeing Carl and his tutelage, and I do feel I became a better person. Today, I teach golf after years on the tour, 20 years on the tour and almost 9 years on the Champions Tour. And I teach, and everything I learned from Carl, I share with my students now. Priceless information that is timeless. He was so far ahead of everyone else with video. And one of the greatest things about Carl is he never really told me how to do it. He just showed me how the greats did it. And together, we sat down and watched it and kind of started making a change to not only my putting, but to my golf game. And like I said, I have story after story after story, but the main point is I've never learned more from anyone in my life than Carl Welty.
Coming up now in a quarter before the hour, well, Lynn Swann has been able to combine his normal Monday morning sports report with a day of golf lessons for himself.
Good morning.
That's why I decided to go to the La Costa Golf School near San Diego and take some tips from the Dean of Golf Instructors, Carl Welty. Carl's been teaching famous pros and mere mortals like me for 30 years. Like a doctor taking a patient's history, he begins by asking some key questions about strengths and weaknesses.
How about your tendency? Do you ever top or do you ever hit the ball fat?
I'm more likely to hit fat. This is where you might say the tail of the tape begins. First, on videotape, everything you do is recorded so it can be played back later in slow motion.
What do you think about the distance from the ball here on this swing?
I mean, this... I don't know. To me, that looks like I'm too far from the ball.
Yeah, it's not too close. That's it, too. Not too close, for sure. So if you were going to change something on that swing, what would you change?
My idea was to change what we saw on the range to this, and just see how the club face, see if you can square it.
But you wouldn't change anything from this one here.
Well, you might, but let's see what that does. And that's plenty to work on.
Yeah. Come on.
I'm 21. And Joey kind of walked into one. He stood about right here and stepped into him. So he wasn't playing one.
Left to right, big time. And it did. Perfect fade.
Hi, my name is Todd Dempsey. I was lucky enough to work with Carl on my game from when I was 14 years old through getting my tour card and beyond that. I can't say enough about Carl and his knowledge of the game. I think a lot of people would agree that nobody studied more video and knew more about how people swung the club than he did. Every time I went to him, I knew I was going to leave with something helpful, something positive. He would always reinforce what I'm doing well, but then give me a couple ideas that I knew to be true because he would show me, Sam Snead or Jack Nicklaus or Ben Hogan, Bobby Jones. He would show me video of them doing it that way. So there was definitely no doubt in my mind that it was the right thing to do. I always left feeling good about my game and where it's going. So he had amazing gift for coaching. He wanted to see his students do well. It wasn't for any other reason than that. You know, he was had the purest motives. He would give his time, go way over the time every time I worked with him. So I just learned so much from his dedication to the game and learning all the time. When I was in high school, he encouraged me to build my own golf clubs, and it's actually had a big influence on what I'm doing now with my persimmon woods that I'm making. probably wouldn't be doing that if it wasn't for his encouragement to do that early on. So got a lot of things to thank Carl for. Definitely miss him, and but we can all learn from the way he did things, and happy to see Craig kind of share about his dad, because he was really an amazing person.
Kick a little to the right.
I'm gonna try and land it in line with the tree.
Okay. No wonder I can't beat this guy. They'll forget Seve Ballesteros when Perez comes on the scene. He made it.
This would leave him, if he could make this putt, at 8 under for the day and 15 for the tournament. Yes! Tom Kite has just tied the course record.
Went down last night and had a little session at the La Costa Golf School with Carl Welty and Jim McLean, and they videotaped my putting, and it looked like my hands were back a little bit at address, and so I was hitting up on the putt and actually putting some backspin on the putt, and
that is where we want to leave the head. Now, at that point, I like to feel as though I have a stake driven down through my head, down through my body, and into the ground, and I rotate around that stake.
Okay, why'd you miss it to the left?
I don't know. Yeah, I was getting too much over the ball.
So Annika on 18, four par, Drano. She shoots 72, and it's win number 4.
So one of the things that Carl talked about, does everybody know what Quintic is? Does anybody not know what Quintic is? So Quintic is a ball launch camera computer system. And I think I'm all in right now. It's about 25,000. And I've had it for maybe 3 or so years. Well, Carl used to film the ball roll, I don't know, John, how many years ago? 50 years ago. So he was doing ball roll stuff long before manufacturers were doing ball roll stuff, I would imagine. Maybe Callaway was doing it. And so everybody has a smartphone. So everybody has a phone that can go 240 frames per second. And one of the things that he did was he drew a cross on the golf ball. And everybody can do this. And I would suggest that everybody go out and do it yourself to your own putting. where you draw a cross on a golf ball, and that you can just use a Sharpie pen. It doesn't have to be a perfect cross. And face the cross towards the phone on the ground about 6 feet away. Then you're going to have to angle your phone the direction the ball is going to roll and see what the cross does. Because what Kite was talking about, if he had the handle back, he might hit it low on the face, which would create the same gear effect laws apply to putting as a driver. So low on the face, backspin, high on the face, probably more overspin. Toe contact is going to create hook spin. Heel contact will create cut spin. So if you have the handle back and you hit up on it, you're going to hit low on the face. You're going to launch it up in the air. It's going to spin backwards. So now you're chipping. You're not putting anymore. You're chipping with a putter. But Carl, like I said, Carl did this 50 years ago. And I got my Quintic during COVID, and I thought I was going to lose my house 3 years ago. And we still film the ball roll with the Sony, TRV 38 or whatever the hell that... 27, yeah. And it was 30 frames per second, and you're getting 240 on your phone. So if you have a student that has poor speed control, uphill, leaving putts short, downhill, just roasting them, it might be because they're launching the ball in the air. You don't need to buy a Quintic. I mean, you can, but you have a high-speed camera in your pocket, and if you put a cross on the ball, you can tell what the ball is doing. That cross, if it has hook spin or cut spin, that cross will turn. It will absolutely turn. If you hit it into the ground, that cross will bounce and that cross will really roll over quickly. And if you see it jump in the air and go backspin, you can see it. Go ahead.
Are you talking like face
up from the front view. Camera on the ground. What I do is, like Xander, he's going to play Zozo in Japan. I will probably have a text with a ball roll at some point. Well, I don't know what time it is in Japan right now. He's probably asleep. But I'll probably, when I wake up, or before I go to sleep tonight, I'll have a video of his ball roll from Zozo. The stuff that he did with Crane, we've got some more video to watch, so we should probably watch it.
We have time.
Do we have? But the stuff that Carl did with Crane, I mean, you'll see it in the video. And I do that with all my players, wherever they are. They'll send me video of what they're doing, and I can see it real time, and we can talk about it. But the roll of the ball is a fundamental of putting. It's an absolute 100% fundamental. If the ball's launched, your read's going to change. Because how's it going to take the slope if the ball's in the air? And how's the ball going to slow down if the only drag on the golf ball is the air itself, not the grass? So the roll is an absolute fundamental, and Carl talked about that eons ago. Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. Anything to see if the ball's launched. Anything to see if the ball's launched. Because a roll board, you can tell if it's hit right into the ground, if the player doesn't have enough loft, or if they're leaning the shaft too much, or if they're hitting down on it. Yeah. Brilliant.
Derek, do you believe in changing the setup for the putter? Because obviously everyone goes to different greens. Like,
yeah. There's the player. That's why he's one of the best, man. Xander travels with three putters. He travels with three putters. His gamer is 2.75 degrees of loft, 71-75 lie. But then the greens aren't always the same, like Blocky knows. I mean, Blocky, everybody knows Blocky's a great player. And that's, why would you change your setup? Oh, well, now, if the greens are really good and he's putting a super long distance, let's say his ball speed's 7.5 miles an hour and he's hitting it 40 feet, 35, 40, 45 feet. He will actually move his hands back just a little because he does the same thing in his putting as he does in his full swing. He'll drag the handle and de-loft it a little bit. So if he's putting off the fringe, he's going to move his hands back because he knows he de-lofts it. But to answer your original question, he travels with three putters. So it's 2.75, 3.75, and 4.5. And it was because of Mexico City at the World Golf Championships. I think DeChambeau might have won that year. And he went with Quintic. No, he called me and he said, dude, I am hitting a 20-footer. I feel like I'm hitting it 45 feet, and it's still short. Because the grass was, I mean, they're putting on 7.5. And you and Blocky, all the tournaments you play, all the tour events, they're 12. And they're perfect. So yeah, he travels with 3 different putters. But for the most part, the tour doesn't change much. I mean, our students, our normal students, you guys, we got to figure out what our students, like, where's Smocky? Coronado, what are your greens normally? Not 12. Yeah, so, I mean, if a guy's playing Coronado all the time, they got 9, he probably should have some loft on his putter, probably. Unless he's got his hands back and he's flipping at it or whatever. But he's got, you got to get the ball out of the nest that the ball's sitting in. I mean, it only takes 15 seconds for the ball to start nesting, right? And this is all the stuff that I learned from Carl. I mean, like I said, I mean, I don't know, 98, 99.
So when they're sending you a film from, let's say, greens that are shaggy like that.
Yep.
So, you know, what I look for is that it's not, it's basically cruises the top of the grass.
Yep. Yeah, but a lot of times when the greens are super shaggy, you'll see the ball hit the edge of the depression and hop and immediately have overspin. And now when it's in the air, what's going to happen when it hits the ground? Immediately there's more spin and more spin and more spin until it gets to true roll. And that's what I see on shaggy or slower greens, soft, super soft greens.
That's what you want also?
No, no. I want it launched on top of the grass and get it rolling. Not really. Not much. Yeah.
That means there's going to be a landing and then a bounce.
Yeah. All bets are off if the ball gets in the air. Who knows where it's going once it, because the ball also can have rifle spin. Does everybody understand what rifle spin is? So if a ball gets in the air, let's say it has 35 RPMs of overspin, but it also has 35 RPMs of hook spin. Well, now it's spinning like a bullet. And a golf ball is going to bounce like a lacrosse ball. So as soon as it hits the ground, it can start hopping sideways. I didn't know what the hell was happening. I would film Xander down the target line with his, and we'd see on perfect greens, we have pretty good greens at the Grand. We'd see the ball kind of going dunk, 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 and I'm like, what the frick, what is that? But it was rifle spin, and we didn't know it. We didn't know that the ball did that. You want to play the rest of it?
All right, started a little bit left, but definitely in the fairway.
I was 5 years old when I went home to my mom and said, Mom, I want to play golf. And she didn't know a thing about golf, and we weren't members of the club, but she took me to the pro shop at Skagit Country Club, where Carl Welty just happened to be the pro. And he took me in, he took me in the back room, let me pick out my favorite 9-iron, cut down a shaft where it fit me, let me pick out a grip, put the grip on, and put my hands on the club to make sure it fit just right, and sent me on my way free of charge. I practiced in my yard for a couple years with that 9-iron, and then I started taking lessons from Carl when I was age 7. Carl, from the very beginning, believed in me and helped me believe in myself, and he had this just, nobody loves the game more than Carl, and he instilled that in me. And he continued to be just an amazing coach for me for my entire career. I don't think there's a better golf coach in the history of the world. I love Carl so much, and I'm just so grateful for the impact he's had in my career and in my life. And every day I still use things that he taught me in my own coaching.
Hey guys, Ben Crane here. Just want to talk about my relationship with Carl Welty. There's no one who's had a more profound impact on my golf than Carl Welty. I worked with him from the time I was 18 to 25. He got me to the PGA Tour. He taught me when I started out with him. I was 104 miles an hour club head speed. By the time I finished up at 25 years old, I was 124 miles an hour, and I was the longest guy on the Korn Ferry Tour. And he taught me how to watch and study my game. I used to make a video DV. My caddy would film me in the practice round. I would get to the FedEx Dropbox by 5 p.m., send it off. He would watch it, and we would be on the phone together, and he would go through every shot with me, and then we'd have a plan for the pro-am, and then I would work out that plan and then go play the golf tournament, played some of my best golf. So forever grateful to Carl for his wisdom, expertise. He's an absolute student of the game, and he is the one that got me to the PGA Tour. So these wins back here are because Carl gave me the foundation to become a very good player because of his incredible wisdom and knowledge and care and investment in me.
Here I am, Jim McLean Golf School with Carl Welty. Say hi, Carl.
How you doing, folks?
Carl has a great passion for the game of golf and has worked with a lot of the game's best players.
Yeah, I was at La Costa for 15 years, and if you had won a tournament on the PGA Tour the previous year, you were invited to La Costa to spend a week with you and your family. And that's how I got to know people like Greg Norman, Curtis Strange, Tom Kite, Tom Watson, Tiger Woods.
The ball right down the middle.
That's a cute shot, isn't it?
Isn't that nice?
Baby, pretty here.
Baby blue.
Purple.
Purple.
You would think I was playing for the TPC Championship. There's so much goddamn fucking tension in my goddamn fucking body.
That looks so good, Jim. Thumbs up there.
Was it solid?
Yeah.
Thing was ripped in.
Behind the foot face.
Set. Started left of the target. And fading left.
60 feet.
The biggest influence on me was meeting my mentor, Carl Welty. He started, I believe, the first golf school west of the Mississippi. Hmm. And then he started kind of helping Jim McLean with some of his schools. He has been, or he was in the forefront of video. So anytime you think about Carl, you think about video.
Yeah.
And anybody in the golf industry thinks about video, they think about Carl.
Oh my gosh, just how particular he was with video angles and how he organized all his videos and just the sheer volume of what he collected over the years.
You couldn't, unless you were there in his house, you wouldn't believe, I could tell you and you'd go, no way, there's no way. And then you would see it and you'd go, this is incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, video that a lot of people haven't even seen. So
top
meeting Carl,
stuff.
Yeah, top secret stuff. And Carl kept everything very close to the vest. But yeah, meeting Carl and having him teach me what to look for and how difficult it was to actually get things right, that was huge for me.
Hey Craig, it's Peter Jacobson calling, PGA Tour player. I worked with your dad. I knew your dad well. I just wanted to tell you how sorry I was to hear about his passing. He was a genius, as you well know. He was such a good guy, so helpful, helped so many players, and he's going to be missed. Geniuses like that don't come along that often. And man, he could analyze that data and help anybody. So just know that I'm thinking about you and your family, and just know what a huge impact your dad had on all of us. So Craig, thanks so much, and take care of yourself. Hope to see you sometime soon. All right, my friend. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.
You heard that sound a lot if you hung out with my dad.
Did anybody notice the T-square on the ground for the front view?
Yeah.
So he wanted the camera perpendicular to the target line. And so if I was ever, and it happened all the time, lazy to put a T-square on the ground when guys were hitting, I would hear it, "Why isn't there a goddamn T-square on the ground, Ueda? How do you know that that's correct?" And so, you know, like I said, so if you're, but if you're, and we film, like, who asked the question, where was the camera? Yeah, how far back the camera was, how it's framed. Listen, who am I or who are we to tell you guys how to film? If you film from the same angles all the time, great. Just don't change it up and you'll see the same stuff. We just happen to film that way. Well, I happen to film that way because I got my ass chewed if I didn't film that way. But the T-square on the ground so the camera's perpendicular is huge. Did anybody else notice what he was doing with the TV screen? He was JC Video or V1 way before V1. He started using dry erase pens on the screen like 50 years ago. He was drawing on the screen like we do with any software we use. He was doing that. This guy was so far ahead of his time, it's unbelievable. The swing fan, where's Doug?
Well, I didn't see Emmerich here, but Emmerich would have a little bit better of a story about this, but he noticed that during in baseball, batting practice, that they're using the swing fan. And so he and Dave Emmerich, a local pro in San Diego, got one of the swing fans and put a golf shaft in it and started using it for golf instruction. So that's kind of the evolution for golf of the swing fan that I think probably everybody in this room probably uses at one time or another.
Yeah, for Crane to go from 104 miles an hour and add 20 miles an hour of club head speed. That was swing fan training. And caving in drivers. So there's another fundamental. Craig, I'm giving all his fundamentals away. Speed was one of his fundamentals. He stopped working with players that didn't have speed. Brandel Chamblee was one of them, right? Brandel Chamblee wanted to work, but he didn't have any speed. So Carl was like, well, what can you really do? And it was, I mean, it's kind of funny. But, you know, speed, the best players in the, go through the history of golf. He's still bitter. Yeah, he might be still bitter. But if you go through the history of golf, all the best players had speed. Yeah. I know it was more kind of history about Carl, but that was what we wanted. Because, quite frankly, not a lot of people know about Carl Welty. And everyone should know about Carl Welty. Every golf instructor in the world should know about Carl Welty. I mean, look, this, unless you were here today, you weren't going to see this. Like, you weren't going to see what he did and the effect that he had on has still on me. All my guys know about Carl. Tom Kim knows about Carl. He just won last week. Self-promoting. Does anybody have any other questions about it? Anything?
Justin.
It was interesting you said that your dad was always right. I only met your dad a couple of times. What I remember, if you can verify this, my memory's getting worse. I remember Gemma and Colin and I were there.
Yep.
And he was trying to help Gemma with her chipping or pitching. He was trying to help her. Later that time in the video, I was like, oh my God, I'm so stupid. I'll listen to him. And I was impressed how honest he was, how faithful he was.
Yeah. Yeah, he didn't have an ego.
Yeah, he really loved leading someone to the answer and never gave the answer. As you heard Weeby and Todd and those guys say, yeah, there was an awkward silence a lot. And if you asked a dumb question, every time you asked a dumb question, he wouldn't look at you. He'd just pause and then he'd move on. And you knew that was a dumb question.
But you know, there was a lot.
I stopped asking dumb questions.
There was a lot of guys that would go see Carl, and then they would leave, and they would come to me, and they go, "He didn't fucking tell me anything." You know, I went to go pay this guy $500 for 3 hours, and he didn't freaking tell me anything. And I'm like, yeah, because he wants you to figure it out. Because if you figure it out, you have it forever. I mean, how many of us teach and we tell somebody something and they, okay, this is what you need to do, and then they blow it off or they forget it. But when they get it themselves, they have it forever. Right? It's never, they'll never forget it.
It's really hard. It's really hard, I feel like, as a parent and as an instructor to know the answer and to withhold it. But like I've said a couple times already, he was so good at that. And if you weren't going to be a part of it and work it out and figure it out yourself, then why should he waste his time with you?
I will say one more thing for all of us. He talked to me about my finances and how much I charge for golf lessons. And I started at $25 a half hour. And I'm embarrassed to say what I charge now, so I'm not going to say it. But he said, whenever you get a good player...
He's under $1,000 an hour.
Yeah. But he said, whenever you have a good player, you need to get a contract with them. And money is hard to talk. How many guys like charge what they think they're worth? Nobody charges what they think. Then raise your rates. Raise your rates to an uncomfortable position. I raise my rates almost every year. It's freaking crazy. And people pay it, which is even crazier. But one of the things he told me was to get a contract with a player. Get him to sign it, get him to agree with it, and have it legal binding. And I started doing that, and he was so proud of me because he didn't do it. He wanted me to learn from his mistakes. So what I would tell everybody in this room, raise your rates. People are going to pay it. People are going to pay it. I have $12,000 worth of bats in my garage. The crazy baseball dad that buys his son bats because he didn't freaking choose golf. Parents are going to pay for lessons. Remember, the kids don't pay for the lessons. The parents pay for the lessons. I don't have a junior rate. If you want to work with me, it's X. Raise your rates. And if you get a good player, get them to sign a contract. Otherwise, they can leave you when they want, which they can if you have a contract, but at least you got paid. I think it's really important. I think it's one of the biggest things that Carl taught me was, like, get your finances in order, charge what you think you should be making, and get a contract. All my guys have contracts. Even the amateurs that want a year deal, they sign a contract.
I'll finish with a little Carl story. You saw the clip of Ben Crane. Like I said, I was kind of like the Swiss Army knife. Carl would call me in if he had a player that was going out on tour and wanted me to show him how to set up camera angles on the greens and during the practice rounds, because it was mandatory that you did it right. So he tells me, I don't know, it's 1990, I don't know, 98 to go to Oregon to meet up with Ben Crane and tell him what I thought about him. And so we go and play Portland, and I was eyed at golf. I wasn't like the guys, Pat Perez and Dempsey, that I was around all the time. So I just kind of decided that I should probably coach like I wanted to, because those guys were so good. And so I showed up, played with Ben, and I was like, that's interesting. We were going to Boise, and he was playing in the Boise Open that was back then. I think it was a Nike Tour event. And so we get there, and we play the first practice round, and Ben's got this snap hook off the tee, hitting trees on the right and swinging it in, and I'm going, what is going on here? And so we keep going through the nine holes of golf, and Ben's like, let's call it. Let's go work on the range. So we go on video and stay there until dark on the putting green, and I'm worn out. I'm just going, well, I don't know how this is possible. This is not going to happen. So I went to a payphone and called Carl, and I said, hey, Carl, what in the hell is going on here? This guy's got—he doesn't have any talent. Like, I don't understand. And he goes, "Well, what do you mean?" And so I kind of gave him the rundown of everything, all the stats and all the charting and all that stuff. And I go, "Listen, if you get this guy on the PGA Tour, I'm going to call you the Wizard for the rest of your life." And sure enough, until the day he died, I called him the Wizard. And it was just, like Ben said, it was every single week you'd go, Ben's caddy or Ben himself would set up the camera angles, FedEx the tapes, they'd be there for Wednesday, they'd go through, review everything, Ben would go play the pro-am, and then be ready for the tournament. And that happened week in and week out, and he started making the top 25s and kept moving, all of a sudden he's on tour and winning, and the transformation of that was, I've never seen anything like it, and I don't know really if at that age of Ben's life that you'd see that again. That type of transformation was incredible. Incredible work by both of them, Ben and Carl. It was insane. So that's my that's the final.
No more questions? One more. I mean, the ball weighs 1.6 whatever ounces. Bermuda's not the best when it's long and shaggy, but when it is cut nice and tight, like East Lake that they're blowing up, I mean, there's hardly any nesting. I think Poana can get bad in the afternoon. But I don't know that it's a whole lot different.
It's just more of a
tight.
Yeah. So my suggestion would be go test it. Go test it down grain, yeah. Test it. Yeah. Straight into the grain, and then test it side grain and see what you get.
So how many of us out here have tournament players? Kids that play like legit tournament golf, college players, anybody teach any tour players? I'm going to give away a secret. So if you watch Xander, when he marks his ball, he puts his mark behind, or puts his ball behind the marker when he's reading. And then when it's time to putt, he'll move the ball in front of the marker and pull his coin back. But most people just let the ball sit there. So who copied us? John Rahm. John Rahm watched Xander putt, because they both play at the Grand a lot. And Rahm's watching him, and he's like, why are you doing that? And Xander didn't, I don't know. But Rahm's a really good player, and really good players watch other really good players. And so if you want your ball to not nest as much, don't have it sitting in the same spot. As soon as you get to the green, pick it up, fix your pitch mark. Walk around, do all your stuff. If you want your ball on the ground, if it's too far away for you to see the coin or whatever, put your ball on top of the coin or put it behind it. And when you're ready to pull the trigger, move it in front, line it up, do your stuff, and go. And it'll be sitting there for a lesser period of time to nest. Takes about 15 seconds for the nesting to really kind of kick in. I didn't study that. Callaway studied that. And I think Doc Grober studied that. Physicist. Hey, you know, from the bottom of my heart, I know it means a ton to Craig, Doug, and John, and Jim McLean wanted to be here, but he's speaking in Spain, I think,
yes.
Or France. I love Carl so much, and to get his story out there is huge for me personally, and I know for Craig too. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.
Hey, let's give another round of applause for that. That was pretty special right there. Yeah, you folks realize that's probably the first time that some of those videos have been watched, so that was pretty unique, and thank you again for sharing.